Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Marty Hom, and today it is my honor and great pleasure to introduce two friends of mine and colleagues, John Maeglin and Paul Gongewer. John and Paul started their careers with the legendary Concerts West in the 70s, promoting concerts by Elvis Presley, Led Zeppelin, Neil Diamond, and John Denver, among a host of others. I had the opportunity to work with John in 1997 when he and Louis Messina promoted Fleetwood Mac's reunion tour, The Dance. They both continue to define and innovate the touring industry. Please help me welcome John Maeglin and Paul Gongewer. It is also my pleasure to introduce the moderator for this event, journalist and author of Laurel Canyon, the inside story of rock and roll's legendary neighborhood. Please help me welcome Michael Walker.
All right, can everybody hear me okay? All right, these are two gentlemen that really need no introduction. We gave them one anyway, but just to...
Monitors on, can't hear you.
Apparently,
can't
hear? Monitors for Paul?
Paul? He can't hear.
You can't? Well, I'll keep talking. Maybe we'll get there in a second in the meantime. But yeah, I'll just yell. Hey, Paul. Before we begin, I just want to sort of lay set the stage, as it were, for these guys. They came into the industry when the industry was really kind of in its infancy, the modern touring and concert business in the 1970s. And we have discussed this among ourselves, that this is a time of incredible innovation and change. And a lot of it was done on the fly. I mean, people were making stuff up as they went along because the infrastructures didn't exist and the rules were kind of not set in stone yet, so they were changing rapidly. Paul and John were through Concerts West, had an enormously significant impact on how the industry does business on the local level and the national level, and it continues to reverberate throughout the industry. It's a standard that exists today that was set back, almost 45 years ago. So on that playing field, as it were, who are you guys? How did you get into this stuff?
I'm John, that's Paul. Well, I started, and I saw Mother Hubbard here, I started as one of the college concert reps back in the 70s, which I think a lot of people got into the industry at that time. But I was fortunate enough to go to work for Concerts West Management 3 in 1978. And at that time, it was Jerry Weintraub and Tom Hewlett and Terry Bassett. And, when you get to learn from guys like that, it's absolutely amazing.
Pick up your mic.
Been in it for a long time. Started as an independent, went from there. Went to Concerts West in Seattle in 1975, I think it was.
Well, you started out with Colonel Parker, though. I mean, wasn't that part of your history? Tell us about that.
When I went to Concerts West, I was assigned to Colonel Parker in the Elvis Presley tour.
And what was it like to, everyone wants to know, it's very rare to get people that worked with Colonel Parker at this point, and he's such a legend in the business. So, I mean, if you can relate some of that to us, that'd be great.
You and I, he don't know. Okay. Working for the colonel, okay.
Oh, I get to tell my colonel story?
Yeah, you can talk about your colonel. Tell colonel stories.
Story.
You can do a story.
Yeah. I was assigned to the Elvis Presley tour, and Colonel Parker booked a show in Bloomington, Indiana in late May, and I think what we found out from that is never go up against the Indianapolis 500. So I spent a month there just doing everything the colonel could think of to try to sell tickets, and... there were these two big, long balconies on either side of the assembly hall there, and I covered them in black visqueen and turned off the air conditioning and the lights, and you walked into the place, you couldn't even see that there was a balcony there, and had to move about 800 people downstairs, and Colonel called me that morning and said, "How you doing? How many tickets you have left?" And I said, "I got about 70 tickets left, Colonel. I'll sell them tonight at the box office," and he went, "No. I want somebody in the box office, but when somebody walks up there, you say sold out." One of our first lessons about sold out philosophy, so to speak.
John, expand on the sold out philosophy and how that's been your sort of...
Well, I mean,
right.
At that time when there was a very, very close connection, obviously, between management and the concert business. We predominantly worked on the concert business side, but at times you got pulled over and you had to work on the management side. So really what it put us in the very, you know, from the beginning of my career, the perspective was always you had to take care of that artist, okay? You had to do what that artist needed, you know, within the framework of what we're doing. But, you know, Weintraub was the manager. We're doing the tours, you know. You couldn't screw around, you know what I mean? You couldn't have side deals. You couldn't have things like that. So having those guys, I mean, one of the things early on that I remember both about, you know, it was funny, with both with Jerry and with Tom, they both used to say, you know, if you don't have anything to do, come into my office and sit down and listen to me talk on the phone. And, you know, it sounds like the weirdest thing in the world, but I found myself later doing that because you could sit there and listen to these guys. Just I did it for years on years and hours on hours just listening to these guys make deals. And it was the same with the Colonel. The Colonel, I had to drive the Colonel home all the time, you know, because he left the office like at 3 o'clock when he was living here in L.A. And every time you'd get another lecture from the Colonel, and it'd be like, what are you working on, Meglin? Well, I'm working on John Denver, Colonel. And, well, you know, let me tell you what I used to do with Elvis, you know, and then you get another Colonel story. But you can't trade that stuff, you know?
When you got hooked up with Weintraub and Conscious West, that was a new business model for the industry. It was quite revolutionary, radical, and not necessarily popular at the time for local promoters. Explain to us again, what was that business model that Weintraub launched first with Elvis and then with the big Zeppelin tours, where it was a single national promoter as opposed to farming it out all over the country to local guys?
You know, it's kind of interesting for me because I didn't know any other. I mean, I grew up under that system. I honestly can say I didn't really even know any agents back then for probably the first 10 years of my life, and I knew very few local promoters because I was put into this system where we did everything ourselves, you know?
What's the advantage of that? How did that, it clearly became the de facto industry standard to some degree, and what were the advantages that gave to the artists and gave to the promoter?
I don't know, what do you think? You can talk some.
I don't have an answer.
I mean, it's like, it's streamlined. It's there aren't need for all these things in the middle, you know? And I mean, people don't like to hear that, but a lot of people get cut out because it's like, you know, there really isn't that need for the role in there. And you know, we, for instance, like venues, okay? The venues were our local partners. Those are the guys that when I started, you got on the phone with the venue guy, you figured out who was going to do the advertising, how are you going to do the ticketing, they put together all your history for you and things like that. And I figured they knew as well about the local market as anybody else did.
Mm-hmm. We talked earlier about that approach also puts the artist in direct contact. The artist and the people that are there locally feel that they are getting a more intimate the relationship with the artist because of you guys being, you know, one hand to God, there you are. You don't have to go through 10 or 15 people. Can you speak to that?
Oh, we use that still today. That's very important. When in the situation that we were in, especially if they were a Weintraub managed act, but even, you know, other artists that worked with us, you know, and we did their tours for them, when we would go into a marketplace, the people in the local marketplace we were working with felt like they were dealing directly with the act, okay? It wasn't the same local promoter that last week they did this show with that guy, next week they're doing this one, and they kind of get into a little formula in that. So when we would come in, we'd actually be very, you know, refreshing because to the local people, it was like they felt like they were closer to the artist. And I'll maintain that got us a lot of better deals than what people had in the local marketplaces.
You said before that one of your approaches is that every artist is unique. You're not doing a cookie cutter operation here. This is going to be every artist will feel like they're the only artist in line. And just tell us how you know how that manifests in your business. How do you do it?
Well, we're not cookie cutter. I think that's our MO, right? It's this is art. No two are alike, okay? So how do you do the same thing for this one that you did for that one, okay? You have to look at each one and per their direction, of course. You know, we're taking our direction from management, for the people around the artists, you know, and sometimes with the artists themselves. And then we have, you know, we design what that tour is based on that artist, okay? It's why we can only do a few at a time, because we don't have it's not a factory. We can't, like, you know, send it through. We don't treat these guys like widgets that go into our machine, okay? They're individual artists. You have to figure out what they want, and then you go out there and execute.
How does that, John and Paul, if you want to answer, how does that manifest? I mean, can you give us, you work with some of the biggest artists in the industry. How did you tailor your approach to, say, the Stones most recently, or take your pick? There's many to pick from.
It's about getting it right. Yeah, it is. I want you to talk on that.
Doing great. You're doing great, man. Go.
I'm going to get laryngitis.
Oh, man. It comes down to about, you know, how do we do it?
Well, number one, it's not us that are doing it. It's a team of people that are doing it, okay? So you got to have a lot of smart people, okay? And our whole thing has always been about finding smart people, okay? And if you can find smart people that get it, and what's our philosophy on hiring people?
Well, we give them the responsibility, and we give them the authority, and we turn them loose, and they either sink or swim, and they usually swim like Michael Phelps.
But can you give us one example of how you tell your operations to an artist? I mean, you've done Prince, you've done the Rolling Stones. Any one of these guys how it manifests itself? But, people would love to hear that.
I mean, the Prince situation to me is like one of the things that is, you know, so pure from a standpoint of there was literally three guys. There was Paul, John, and Prince. Okay, there was no contract. There was no manager. There was no lawyer. There was no business manager. There was no agent. Wasn't even a band when we started, I don't think. It was just him, okay? And when we got done with that tour...
This is the Musicology tour,
yeah, this is the Musicology tour.
I want you to, just a little bit of background, that would be good. It's just how...
Oh how that came about?
Yeah.
That was kind of interesting. We were... it was when we were mounting the Celine show in Vegas. One day, literally, Teresa walks in and says, Prince is on the phone. And I said, yeah, right. And he said, no, Prince is on the phone. And I went, okay. And I had met him once or twice before, but, you know, went in and got on the phone. And he said, I find this thing that you're doing with Celine Dion very interesting in Vegas.
What you were doing, that you didn't interrupt you, Cookie, said that was a residency show, and she was doing a long string of shows at one place, right? Was that
correct?
The same? Okay, just so people know. But then,
yeah, okay, so the Celine, this is like, we'll go back to that. The Celine residency attracted Prince, okay? And Prince came out, and we sat, and he saw the show, and it was very funny, the whole show, he's sitting next to me going, she's lip syncing, and I'm like, no, she, but when it was done, he was like, she has the most fantastic voice I've ever heard in my life. But anyway, we walked around afterwards. I showed him, you know, how we had built, you know, our own wardrobe department and dry cleaning and physiotherapy and, you know, you name it, because we went the mile on that show. And he just really loved it. But he came in and he sat down at the very end. He came in and he sat down with Celine. And he was like, Prince was in his lime green leisure suit all the way to the matching boots. And Celine's in her jeans and a T-shirt. And she's talking to, you know, they had a wonderful conversation about what it was like doing the residencies, okay? But it was literally, he left a week later, I get a call from him, and Paul and I go up to the Beverly Hills Hotel, and he's like, if this is the way you guys treat artists, I want you guys to handle my stuff. And that's what began the entire Prince relationship, you know? I should thank anyone in the world for Prince, I should thank Celine for that, you know?
We ended up
actually producing that tour, so we did everything. We paid for sound and lights and videos and trucks and buses and the band and the crew and everything. And in the end of it, at the end of that tour, he ended up making 50% of the gross revenue went to him. And that's unheard of. But just being able to do things so efficiently and combining the operations and making it tight, we were able to pull that off.
That tour is also significant for having packaging, or not packaging, selling the CD as part of the price of admission. I mean, that worked out really well for Prince and you.
He made more on a record than he'd ever made on a single record in his life on that. And it was great, because every time we'd go out and do another leg on the tour, the album go back up to number one.
You know, that's another example of innovation, how you thinking out of a new situation, whereas putting somebody out on the road, especially a big act, for months and months and months, the logistics are punishing, the margins get thinner and thinner in a lot of cases. In this case, you took with Celine, you took an old business model and kind of flipped it, like just like Weintraub did. I mean, talk a little bit about what made you do that with Celine in the first place. Why do a residency? Why not just keep her on the road?
I was riding my bicycle one day and I fell off and I hit my head really hard. No, I'm kidding. No. I don't know. When Gongwer and I heard about it, we heard about this Celine show idea before even we were part of AEG. We tried to run around and see if we could find the money for the thing. It hit me, you know, at that time, O was such a big show, and it was the hottest thing, you know, out there with Cirque du Soleil, and here you've got this, you know, which I knew maybe from living in Canada for those years, that, you know, how big she was and on a worldwide basis. And it just seemed the marriage to me, 1+1=3, okay? But very few people believe that.
Yeah, I remember Streisand's manager telling John, there's only two people in the world that believe in this show, you and I can't figure out who the other one is.
It's true, thank you, Marty. But no, it just seemed like it worked, and what happened is that we couldn't find the money. Paul and I were operating on our own then. We had this backer that Darren Libinati had actually found for us. It was like helping us, backing us on these tours, and you know, the idea of coming up with the kind of money for that kind of thing was just like a dream. But we, in the meeting that we agreed to sell the company to AEG, at the end of that meeting, Lewicki turned to me and he said, you know, John, tell Phil about that Celine idea, you know, and it took about 20 minutes really just to explain it to Phil, and he said, you know, I think we should do this, and
the risk was $150 million, and that was big money back then.
Yeah, it was, I mean, it was like, you know, and everybody that could tell you, everybody, you know, hey, you're going to do a 4,000-seater. Everybody else got a 2,000-seater. And well, you do a 4,000-seater and you do five shows a week. That means you're doing four arenas a week. Do you think she could do 50 arenas in Las Vegas? And I'm like, no, don't talk to me like that, you know. But it worked. It worked. And the residency model, you know, really kind of was born from that. Yes, Steve? That's like that story we were telling at lunchtime.
Sorry. So that the experience with that then talked, now Prince goes does the same thing with you guys, and you do the long residency at the O2, and et cetera, et cetera. So talk about that.
Man, remember the night that he got ripped off at... No, It was really funny, because when he came to us, Prince was the one, by the one, who said 21, because he got hooked on this thing, you know, 3121, and all the tickets had to be 3121. It was his new mystical number. By the way, it was just the address of the house up off of Mulholland that he was living in. But he couldn't have picked, like, 7985. It had to be, like, 3121, you know? So anyway, he came up with, we got to do 21 shows. We're going to do, you know, and we're going to do it at £31.21. And I remember, especially, it was funny, Randy and Rob Hallett were both like, oh, you got to talk him out of this. We can't, you know, you got to tell him it's never going to happen. I'm like, well, if we tell him it's not going to happen, then he'll fire us now. Why don't we just try it? And then if it doesn't happen, we can get fired then. Made sense to me. Kind of worked out that way, didn't it? Yeah, I mean, we don't know. The answer is, you know, we don't know. We do the best we can at putting these things together, and it works with the support of, you know, all of these guys out there. This is our family out here. These are the people we do these things with, and we do it on the road with. So you guys know. You know what it means to put it together. We love doing the job, you know. We're kind of more project guys than we are company guys. Does that make sense?
Yeah, close enough.
Going off script.
That's okay. Going off script is good. You've evolved your business more recently by some strategic things through AEG and some other actions. But I think we'll talk about when you were saying it was necessary for you, as we came into the 90s, into 2000s, for you guys to introduce yourself to a new set of talent, a new set of managers, a new set, because times were changing, people were leaving the business and coming into the business, and you thought it was very important that you had that new set of contacts. You couldn't just sit still anymore. So remember we talked about that?
Yeah, it was this little company called Golden Voice, yeah, who we love and... Long-term, that was a long-term thinking. You know, I met Paul and Rick doing a Bowie Nails tour, and I know it was John Malm or Alex Cochin wanted us to cut them in, and we gave them a buck a ticket, and that's the first time I'd met them, and we kind of got to know each other from that, and, you know, occasionally would talk, and they were doing some really cool stuff. Paul and I left SFX when it started, and Paul and I, that's kind of when we reformed. And while we were, you know, getting our little things going, and we got the Dixie Chicks, and I think we got Mariah, and Paul T came in one day and said, look, would you guys take a ride with me out to the desert? I want to show you this site. And we went out there and looked at it. And I remember standing there, and he said, look, I did Pearl Jam here years ago, and then I tried to do this festival, and didn't work. Gongoers were like, hey, it takes 3 years to make one of these things work, you know, don't give up. So we ended up backing them at the end of that thing on this thing. And then the next year, when we sold the company, in January, so our second Coachella was coming up, I think, at that time. It was a negative on our books. Coachella didn't mean anything. Nobody wanted Coachella back at that time, okay? And I think we even got accused of it, trying to throw junk into the sales deal, whatever. But the point was, we wanted Golden Voice. So LiWiki came and said, what do you guys want to do next? And we said, we want to buy Golden Voice. But unfortunately, Golden Voice had just signed a deal with the Nederlanders. And they had, and at the time, if anybody local remembers, when Staples opened, the Nederlanders had an exclusive on Staples Center. So here AEG goes and buys Concerts West, so now the Nederlanders are pissed off because they think that, oh, their exclusive is going to be threatened, right? And we want to get Golden Voice, but they've signed a deal with the Nederlanders. So I remember we had this breakfast at the Jonathan Club at 7:30 in the morning. It was LiWiki and Neil Papiano, I think their attorney David Green, and me. And at that meeting, we had to get Nederlanders to rip up that contract. So I traded Moss Jacobs in the Santa Barbara County Bowl to the Nederlanders, and we took Paul and Rick. And the reason we took Paul and Rick back then had nothing to do with Coachella. It had to do with the relationships that they had with young and with developing artists and with young managers and people. It didn't, you know, I mean... It took a while till, you know, we always believed in Coachella. It wasn't the main focus at that time. It took Wiley to turn the Sahara Tent into the birthplace of EDM for Coachella to take off.
You know, another more contemporary part of aspect of your business now is just business models are changing. You guys told me the great story about essentially outrunning the secondary market by flooding the market with so many tickets. If you had an artist that liked to work, you could get him out there and stay, keep him out there, and there's it kind of dries up. Can you tell that story?
I think that was the case with Prince.
Yeah.
He just decided, I'll work as many shows as I can in a given market. And when we started Musicology, our people were telling us, you might get one out of L.A., you're only going to do 10,000 people at Madison Square Garden, and this thing is a major stiff. And it turned out to be the biggest tour of the year. I think we did 6 in New York, 6 in L.A., 5 in San Francisco, 5 in Chicago. It just went on and on. We just kept adding tickets. And the effect of that is really to kill the secondary market, to kill the scalp market, because you put so much inventory into the public.
Right.
It's the reverse of the Stones.
Yes, reverse on the Stones, exactly.
And what's
Yeah, because they're only going to work 25 shows a year, maybe, 30 shows a year. So we have to maximize each one of those shows. And we do that through, well, John, you talk about, you know, you were the architect of it.
You know, I think we got into the premium ticketing thing a long time before other people did. I remember back when David Goldberg and David Marcus at Ticketmaster came in with wanting to take ticket exchange or team exchange at that time into our kind of into our world. You know, we as an industry, you know, the end result is much better for us, I think, than it has been for the record companies thus far. But, you know, when tickets went digital, okay, there was an entire cottage industry that just totally exploded, okay? And then we started trying to fight that cottage industry, okay? The scalpers and that, whereas, and I think, I don't know, I may have said it or somebody said it a long, long time ago, it's that we don't have a scalping problem, we have a pricing problem, okay? And the example of Prince was, let's take that out of the marketplace by increasing the inventory. The case with the Rolling Stones is we don't have a lot of inventory, and we get sick and tired of people selling seats for $100 and then watching somebody else sell them for $500. And I believe that money belongs in our industry, okay? And we've worked very, very hard to keep that money in our industry. Our method is it goes to the band, okay? We think it belongs with the band. That's why people are coming to see the show. And, you know, we've fought like hard to keep that. But we know all the techniques. We know what everybody does out there. You know, there's so many middle companies now that exist in that space, you know. But it's just something that we need to get that money. And I think everybody has been doing it. It's good. It makes our industry a lot healthier.
It all kind of started with Colonel Parker. And when we did the Elvis tours, and we had to make sure, we went out to put the shows on sale, and actually we're at the box office, and all the tickets were sold at the box office. We had to make sure that those first 10 rows went to the public. And so our ethics, or whatever you want to call it, as we moved forward, was the first 10 rows go to the public, and we didn't hold anything in there. And one day we woke up and realized the bots are buying all those tickets, and these guys are buying a Mercedes on every tour. And we just went, wait a minute, we're idiots. And that's when we decided to take it back.
You know, there's an old saying that talent finds talent, talent also begets talent. And you, both of you, had a pretty long association with Michael Jackson and the Jacksons over the years. But the story of how Michael Jackson came to you is actually pretty fascinating. It involves Prince again. He's sort of like the doppelganger of this. But anyway, please.
Man, at the end, a very, very sad story, of course, but it was very, very interesting. Good neighbor of ours named Peter Lopez called me one day and said he'd been on the phone with Michael for 2.5 hours, and he wanted him to represent him, what did I think? And I said, well, we should get Paul on the phone, because Paul's done produced a couple of his tours, that kind of preceded it. The very first meeting we had was over at the Wynn. And it was funny, we walked in the room, Peter brings us in, and Michael comes out of the room, and the first thing Michael does is, Paul Gangawea, Paul Gangawea. Whenever I saw Paul Gangawea, I knew everything was going to be okay. That was like literally his first words. So we spent the second meeting. He wanted to do a miniseries on King Tut. That was interesting. We had to sit through 6 hours of listening to King Tut. But he did come over that night to see 3121 and see Prince. And that was one of the most hilarious nights, because Michael actually came over by himself. No bodyguards, no nothing. Showed up at the back door, came in. We had those twins that were singing for Prince at the time. I didn't know what to do with them, so I take them downstairs. We had one of those little, you know, like liquor rooms. It's a room that's made out of chain link fence, you know. And we had cleared that out and put some couches in there and some purple lighting gel over it. And Michael's running around, jumping on the couches, grabbing the thing, going, wow, this is a cool room. What did you guys do here? And we're like, well, it's a liquor room. We took a liquor out and put some gel on the light, you know, put a couch in here, you know. But anyway, so I go grab Trevor, and I'm like, Trevor, you know, Mikey's here. He wants to see Prince. And Trevor's like, no. Prince won't see him, man. He won't see him. And I'm like, what am I going to do with him? You know, and Prince the whole time's going, where's Prince? Michael's going, where's Prince? Where's Prince? And I'm going, holy shit, you know. So anyway, Prince never sees him, but the dressing room is downstairs in the green room there. So right before we finally figure, by now we got a couple more people there with Michael. We're going to take him up the stairs, which is right off the stage. and take him out to his little booth to watch the show. And as we come up, Prince is walking across the back of the stage and sees me and comes walking over to me. He gets about 10 feet and sees Michael right behind me. And he sprints full speed down the hallway and runs into the kitchen of the restaurant. And Michael's behind me going, "Is that Prince? Is that Prince?" And I'm going like, holy, you know, but you can't make that shit up.
No, you can't.
We've all seen it, right? Everybody out here. I've seen a lot of nodding heads. We've all seen it.
But it's kind of touching that these guys are actually fans of each other. I mean, and you see that over the years. Sometimes it's between opening act and headliner, and sometimes it's just, you know, the talent, something like that. It's pretty interesting. You came out of the 70s, which was, I started at the top of this thing. This is the wild frontier when it came to this stuff. You guys being at the forefront of the wild frontier, tell us some great 70s stories. You have to go back to that era and try to remember something out of that. It's just, Shep Gordon's going to be doing a panel tomorrow, and I guarantee you that they'll be rolling in the aisles when they talk about how they got the Alice Cooper's, you know, $25,000 Busby Berkeley set. They'd expected to go on a stage on Broadway for 6 months, and then they lost that, and they had to start loading it in trucks in January. It was all made out of steel. And Joe Gannon, the guy who designed it, said you could have hung the Empire State Building from the side of this thing. It was so heavy. But they somehow managed to get this thing across the country. That strings of one-niners in the middle of the winter. And Shep Gordon said to Joe Gannon, "What did you just get me into?" Because they didn't. Shep Gordon said, "We didn't know you couldn't do that, but we just went ahead and did it anyway." And of course, it changed the touring. Changed radically after that. The Bear stage was pretty much dead into the 70s and 80s. The productions got more professional. From that era, is there some stuff like that?
I mean, there's a lot of guys in this room that understand and realize a lot of that stuff. There are many of us that, whether it was the evolution of a barricade, you know, and how many we all were underneath it, so many shows. And you know, I think that there was, you know, like I think we were saying earlier, we've always been project guys. I like the fact that a tour starts and that it ends. You know, a festival, it starts and it ends. We never, you know, look, I'm still dressing like the 70s because that's where I came from and I like it there. But I came into this business because I wanted to be able to go to work like this and I didn't want to have to wear a suit. And I think that's like why a lot of us actually came into this stuff. And I love putting on the shows. So we learned so much of that stuff on the early ages. I'm trying to think of a good story though.
One time I spoke to Peter Rudge's right-hand woman for the Stones 72 tour, Mary Beth Medley, I think her name was, and she said, I said, how in the world did you plan a tour back then? There was no cell phones, the communications were so primitive. And I said, how did you do it? How did you keep these things on the road? And she said, well, at the beginning of the tour, I get out a Rand McNally road atlas, you know, and map out how many cities were 300 miles apart, because that's as far as the trucks could get. And just go from there. And I think the most sophisticated form of communication was telex. I mean, they didn't have faxes back then. So,
I remember we had a little thing up in the Seattle office at town. It was called a Quantrell machine or something. You would put it, if you had Quip. Yeah, if you would put like the document on that thing and it just rattled around for like 30 minutes till it got to the other place. But I think it was, my best story about him was when I started. I remember walking, you know, and I started up at Concerts West. I remember going into his office. He would always scare the shit out of me. He had this big beard. He was like this. I mean, he was very mean back then, very, very mean. And I finally got the courage to walk into Gongaware's office one day, and I said, you got anything to do? And he hands me the Bad Company itinerary, and he says, yeah, set up a limo company in every one of these cities. And I went, okay. And I kind of walked to the door, and I go, how do you do that? And he leaned down and he picked up one of those big yellow pages and he threw it at the door as hard as he can and he said, there's one of those in every fucking city. That's what it was like back then.
It's true.
I think last week was TourLink again. For those of you that go to the thing, it's a great event and they have an event called You Can't Make This Shit Up, and they basically just kind of tell stories not too different than that. But the Also in the 70s, concert business continues to be a cash business, of course, but it was a cash business. I mean, there, every road manager from that era, maybe still happens today, walking out of arenas with $20,000 to $30,000 in single bills and getting on the back of a plane. Patrick Stansfield, the Rolling Stones, unfortunately, late tour guy, told a story about coming into Hawaii from Australia, and they had to divvy up the money through all the roadies, and one of the roadies kind of blew it. They're bringing in essentially $400,000 in cash in the United States, so they didn't want to declare it, so they had to divvy it up to just under $10,000 per guy. So everybody in the tour was holding this money, except one roadie kind of blew it and told the customs guys, and then there went the $100,000. I mean, money, talk about it. How is it dealt with now, then, and maybe now?
It was scary back then. I mean, there were a lot of times where you had cash. My favorite cash story was always Hewlett's cash story about Elvis Presley in Providence, Rhode Island. Because everybody knows, remember that Holiday Inn, that round Holiday Inn next to Providence Civic Center there? Okay, so this was his story. He said he was there for Elvis, came back, settled the show, took all the money out of his briefcase, put it underneath the mattress, got up the next morning, drove on to like New Haven or wherever they were playing the next day, never opened up his briefcase. Got to the show that night, opened his briefcase, realized where he'd left the money. He drove all the way back to Providence, still had his key, went up to the room, opened it. There was a couple sleeping in the bed. And he said, excuse me, I know this looks strange, but I was staying here last night. Went and lifted up the mattress, pulled all the cash out, and left. I don't know if it's true, but it's a good story, Tom.
That's great. You know, money... You've seen artists at the various points of their careers when they're on the way up and they're cruising and they're unfortunately on their way down. Again, back to Michael Jackson, when you were doing This Is It, that was a kind of a dire time in his life for financially. I mean, can you describe what you encountered and how you were trying to help him at that juncture?
Yeah, he was broke, or very close to being broke at that point. We had to make a money, so Tim Woolley and I went through. Everybody felt entitled, like they should be paid more than anybody else because they were working for Michael Jackson. He had more money than God. So it was a really difficult thing to rein it in and get people to accept, fair market value for their services, I guess you'd say. I think that was probably the hardest part of, putting that thing together.
Yeah, and is it when you encounter an artist in that situation, I mean, since you're such a personalized outfit, it doesn't have to be Michael Jackson necessarily, but I mean, how privy are you to the backstage drama of these people's lives? And does it, how do you deal with that?
I try not to.
Yeah, but I think your thing is you become close with people when you're on the road. Almost like a second family that you have. Some we mentioned at lunch, but then when you go home, sometimes you never talk to those people again until you go on a tour with them, I mean, look, Marcel's time with Michael, when Paul was working with Marcel, was part of he gave me some Michael Jackson shows that helped me get Pace Touring started up back at the very first things that we did. So, I think... especially in this group of people that are here, because in this group we have so many people that we've all spent so many years on the road together. So I think it's about respecting what everybody... That's something the story I learned early on, I learned one of these from Gongaware, was, I had one guy telling me, you don't hang around the crew, you don't hang around those people, and just hang around the management, the band, and I had him telling me... You treat that guy driving the truck as well as you treat that guy singing on the stage. And I've tried to live that in my whole career with people. I think we're both kind of operators at heart. We're not really we're not really executives per se. We like to put on fucking concerts.
You have a division of power that's very efficient between the two of you, I think. To tell us about that, who gets to vote no and what happens?
Well, between us, we have a deal. And if we talk about everything and then one of us goes and does it, whatever we decide to do. And the thing we have between us is that if either one of us says no, it's a no. And the only reason I'm here is because I didn't want to pull out my no on for this thing. We have never, ever pulled out our no, either one of us. We just figure out a way to talk it out and work it out.
Let's go to the present day for a while. You were facing, many challenges these days. Everybody in this business is. Talk about that. How are you dealing with it, and what are the issues?
Look, to us, it looks, we see a lot of similarities between old Concerts West Management 3 and now even Live Nation and their management company today and Rock Nation. It's a lot of similarities to it. I can't blame them at all. I can understand that whole vertical business. I think for us, you know, it's always been about relationships when you do tours, okay? Because trust me, if you don't get along with somebody, you're not going to be doing their tour very long, okay? So you got to get along and you have to develop a trusting relationship. And I will go back to when we started working for Jerry and Tom and Terry back in those days, okay? You put everything on the table. That was our thing. We put everything on the table with the artist. Paul and I have just been practicing that same thing for 40 years. That's all it's been. And the way we continue doing that is by finding other smart people. You know, one of the first people to come on board with us was John Nelson when we did the Celine Dion deal, okay? No way in hell I could have ever done a tenth of what we did without him and without the team that he put together. You know, it's the same with Adam Wilkes and what he's built in Asia for us now, and how we've built a bridge in between kind of Japan and Australia where we can go and do 12, 14 shows. So you gotta be global today in this business. You have to. He and I probably spent more time, and a lot of people in this room, we spend a lot more time out of this country than we do in this country today. It's very much a global business. We want to go out and do exactly the same thing that we've done here for many years as Concerts West and just do that around the whole world.
Live Nation, Concerts West, compare and contrast.
Look, I got a lot of good friends over there. They got a lot of people that know how to do things, but I think structurally we're very different, okay? You know, we kind of grew up as arena guys in the beginning. That's why, like, one of the things we did when we started Arena Network up, even we started Arena Network at the same time we started Concerts West back up. But I think it's about more boutiques for us. But I mean, we live in a wonderful company. We have a tremendous owner, never said no to us on a single project that we have gone in. If we had our shit together, and that, Phil has never said no, okay? A lot of the people that helped grow this company were very, very important people. They all have played their roles in that, you know? Jay doing what Jay is doing today is tremendous. It's time for that in this company, okay? But what's beautiful about what we get to do at AEG is that we each get to go and do our businesses, okay? You know, Louis is here, and he gets to, you know, when he became Country Louis, and he's great, go be Country Louis, and Barry Marshall, go be Barry, and Deborah, be Deborah, and Madison House, be Madison House. It's like a Golden Voice, be Golden Voice. It's, you know, I just believe in that model. I don't believe in consolidation and, you know, making everything a system.
Right. Where does it go from here, though? I mean, what you're facing, one of the things you're facing is, we talked about this earlier, is that I think you coined it, live is the last analog. It's the one thing you got to show up and pay your money and see the person live. Talk about that a little bit and talk about the currency of that in a world being taken over by augmented reality, virtual reality. There's the beginnings of that creeping into this business as well. And how does that impact you guys?
What do you think? VR, all that, what's it going to do to us?
We're golden.
We're golden?
Yeah. Why are you golden? Why would that?
There's no way to replicate it. There's no way to replicate live in the internet or anything else. What's your line about sex?
I said we're in a good business until the day they make virtual sex better than the real thing. We got nothing to worry about. No, it's like live. We fortunately get, you know, you can't press more, you can't, you know, print more,
Dave and Dale can, but we can only fit so many people in the room, you know, and so that's the beauty. And you're there. You're either there when it happened or you watched it somewhere. I don't care. It's not the same. And so I'm very, like, one of my things is the ticket. I hate discounting. I hate all that shit because, to me, that's our holy grail. That's our value. And the second we lose that value, then we're all fucking out of business, okay? Second, that thing's worthless. Goodbye, okay? We have to maintain the value of that ticket. And, in fact, we got to be getting the value of that ticket over on our side.
How do you do that?
Dynamically pricing. Again, we believe that you make those decisions on with the artist or with their handlers and that, okay? Because every artist wants to come off in the way they want to come off, okay? Where they can do what they can do, and some of them can only work so many times, so they need to make as much as they can. Well, that should be their decision for the most part, you know? I think that it's inevitably we need to close the ticket. What I mean by that is we just need to know where the ticket is at all time, just like an airline, just like your hotel room, like anything else. I mean, they can do it with, you know, books now. We can definitely do it with seats, okay? And we need to open our distribution, okay? And we got to quit telling people that the only place you can buy our product is at this one location. It's just, again, we overcomplicate things. In our business, we're in a real simple business. Most of us quit college before we graduated because we only need to add, subtract, multiply, and divide. That's it. You don't need to do anything more.
You talked earlier, we were discussing this about, which one of you guys said this, but it's like you can't think of the last time you actually interacted with an agent. And you were I don't know if you were lamenting that or you were booking for agents for talent.
Oh. The Asia, that was, you know, we found a guy, actually originally worked for Steve Sebesma over there, just a brilliant kid. Again, talk about finding smart people, you know. And we found Adam, and just kind of, I knew he was the right guy. Just kind of knew he was the guy to put it together. And it was funny because I had to hire him based on the premise that he was going to make sure our buildings in Shanghai and Beijing were booked, okay? Because nobody else wanted to go mess around in Asia. But between Adam and I, the whole job was you're going to build a bridge in between Japan and Australia. And we're up to 14, 16 markets deep that we're going there. So it's one of the most important markets out there in the world today.
Every parent has favorite children. What's your favorite tour? I say everyone has favorite children. You know, mom likes you best, and you have all your children. You love them undividedly and mostly equally. But there's always a favorite somewhere over the years. Is there an act that you work with or acts that? That really kind of moved you, and you feel like, you know, they're all special, but this one's especially special.
You go first.
Well, there's not just one, there's several, but I mean, the one I can think of offhand, the first one at least is Prince, just because it was just the two of us and Prince, and that thing was, everybody said it was not going to work, and we ended up being the highest grossing tour of the year, and Prince was just fantastic to us. He was amazing. And we didn't have to go through an agent to add a show or a manager or an accountant or any of that stuff. We just did it, and it worked so well. And he was just so happy with that tour. That was one that I can think of. You know what? Doing McCartney tours with Barry Marshall, I've just loved those because the music was so fantastic. I would try to get my work done as quick as I could so I could go out and watch that show every time, you know? And now, my favorite now is the Rolling Stones. It's just, I can't believe they pay me to do this.
How are you, John? Anything like that?
I did love John Denver tours, I have to admit that. Okay, I did. They were so much fun. We played softball, we barbecued. It was just such a great time. And the times on the road with Patty, with Stansfield, those were always good. Celine, very important to me. Just because of what it meant, all of that type of thing. The Prince thing was very, very cool. you know, a lot of years with the Beach Boys and that type of stuff. So that creates another family within you. You know, I didn't like the swan song days. Peter Grant scared the shit out of me. He was scary. You know, I fucked up once at the...
You got an instant swan song as Led Zeppelin and Bad Company.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, we were playing the Forum with Bad Company, Desolation Angels, 79? Yeah. Anyway, my job was to put that railing around the whole stage, you know, so they wouldn't walk off it, you know. And we
apparently there was an issue at that time.
We didn't fly sound back then, so we stacked your PA. So I had left a little gap from where the railing went up on the side of the, on the stairs, there's a little gap, and then railing, and then the PA stack. Well, Peter walked up watching the first couple shows, turns, you know, behind the pack, turns to walk down the stairs and grabs the railing on the outside. And that was the big, like, 7-foot Forum stage back then. Fell 7 feet straight to the floor. I just remember seeing Weintraub and Hewlett over, and they looked at Peter, and then they looked at me, then they looked at Peter, and I figured this is the end of my life. And Peter got up and scurried away. He was hoping nobody saw him. But I just thought, I'm dead.
You know, the business in those days is, and I think it still is, but those were the days of the legendary characters. And you got to interact with some of these, you know, Weintraub himself. Is, you know, in fact, he did write a book about his life, and it was pretty entertaining. Peter Grant is another example. Talk more about Peter Grant, because everybody's got, had interacted, had said he was either like a teddy bear or a tyrant. He was, you know.
Look, I was young. I was a kid. You know better. I scared the shit out of me. All those guys did. Peter, you know, Paul Rogers beat me up back then on the road. So.
Paul Rogers beat you up?
Why? Sport.
Oh, sorry.
Sport, yeah. I don't know. I mean, what was it like back then? It was hard. It was tough.
But there's also the local, when there were little fiefdoms around the country of promoters, everybody had their territory. Graham had San Francisco, you know. Well, describe that sort of action back then. And that was something that you were going into and essentially blowing up.
Well, so. I didn't do the Zeppelin show. Did you do the Zeppelin Oakland show? No.
Oh, the Oakland.
You did that? Well, I did. We went in. I remember we went in with Bad Company right after that. And it was just, it was really tense between all the BGP people and all the concerts.
This, just to interrupt you, this
is Swan Song guys.
It was that infamous Oakland concert where the John Bonham and Richard Coles.
I think, who was it? It was Coble, right? Coble beat up somebody. Yeah, Richard beat somebody up.
They beat up somebody from Bill Graham's production company in a trailer while the concert was going on.
Yeah.
And then they had to play the next night. And that's what you were
You just
to.
Hoped, back then you just hoped it wasn't you being the guy beat up. Okay. So, no, I remember, I mean, no, that was Richard Coble, but anyway, when we went back, it was just really tense. It was like, it was always tense between us and BGP anyway, okay? I mean, I was sitting in the dressing room when we did, or not dressing room, the box office at Cow Palace when we did, like, the Five Nights of Neil there, and sat there watching Weintraub and Bill Graham go, you know, Bill gets up and writes over Jerry Weintraub presents, right? Bill Graham presents, and then he'd write Jerry Weintraub presents, and they just ran out of room, you know. But Weintraub was such an amazing, you know, influence. He was such a power, you know. There were just, you know, whether those people really exist today in the way, when they walked into the room, they just, you know, it's like they just captivated the room.
And where did that come from, though? Because it was you know, Weintraub had not set out to become a concert promoter. I mean, it was the job description didn't really exist for the most part. But these guys all had a real definable presence. They were kind of like the old it's like an honor among thieves. It would be they would try to pull stuff constantly. I mean, I had a booking agent told me one time he went backstage. He was leaving the business. He went backstage for a pretty prominent promoter on the East Coast. He said, "Look, I'm leaving the business tonight." And he said, and the promoter said, "Okay, you can ask me anything you want tonight. Any question, I'll answer it." And the booking agent said, "Yeah, show me where you cheated." So he said, "Okay, follow me." So he takes the booking agent backstage, and the band's on stage, and the catering's already laid out for the after show. And there's a 10-gallon tub of ice cream. He said, and the promoter said to the booking agent, "All right, take a spoon and get some ice cream." And the guy said, "All right." So he takes a spoon and gets some ice cream. And then he goes, "All right, so what?" And the promoter goes, "Try to get some more." And so the guy reached into the bowl in his spoon, and it stopped. And what he realized the guy had done was, it's a 10-gallon tub of ice cream, but he filled it up 8/10 with plaster of Paris before the show and put a little bit of ice cream on top of it. And he looked at the booking and he just said, that put two kids through college. And he said,
That was a Bill Graham move, wasn't it?
But, I mean, you guys must have encountered stuff like that over the years. I mean, what?
Oh, man, we had so many great trips. Marty Hom played one of the best ones I ever saw. That was getting the guy to getting at every night on Fleetwood Mac. We'd be in the catering room, and suddenly a security guy would go up to Bruce Kapp and go, excuse me, sir, are you the limo driver? We need you to move your limo. And Bruce goes, oh, I'm not the limo driver. And it kept happening to him city after city after city. So I think it was Marty and Doug Klaus that probably created that thing. But, you know, you do that while you're out on the road. I mean, those are just, you know, I can't think of any. I'm drawing a blank on stories right now.
Gonga tarp. How many times did you rent that tarp?
Yeah, Gongaware had Gonga tarps. Do you guys remember that? It was like BGP, you know, they rented the tarps for concerts on the green from Gongaware out of his little warehouse in Spokane, Washington. Paul always had those little deals going on.
No, I remember being backstage at concerts in that era also, and having, when they're doing the box office cut, there would be guns on the table. I mean, so it's kind of a rough business. Has it gotten any cleaner since then, or are you still fearing for your life at every split?
Well,
can we move on?
All right, we can move on. All right. Sure. All right, let's move on.
Where are we at now?
We are now, we are talking about, let's talk about your lives right now and the structure of your company right now. And you had mentioned before, though, I think you were talking about that you were dealing with agents as opposed to, the last time an agent, a band's, an act, a talent's agent actually contacted you for, you know, I mean, talk about that.
Well, I mean, we're, you know, it's hard to say because we're one group within a big company, okay, and we kind of have our style of doing business. Maybe historically it's kind of offensive to agents, but the fact is we've worked with just as many agents as we haven't on many tours. I believe that's, you know, that's an artist's decision. But the one thing, it just concerns me about today, okay, and if you own management and you got a promoter, I know the whole time I worked for Weintraub that if he managed the band, Concerts West did the concerts. I can't ever think of an exception to that rule. So I just got to assume that that's the way they will operate. But if you operate that way and you got, you know, you're kind of, the agents are somewhat very much beholden to the managers, you know? So, I mean, there was a time, and you know, I think I can tell it because everybody's passed, but Weintraub, Hewlett, Mike Love, Robert Corey, they all bought Sandstone and Amphitheater in Kansas City. This was back in somewhere in the 80s. And Hewlett walked in one day and said, you got to book it. And I'm like, I'm not a local promoter. I don't want to book an amphitheater. And he's like, no, you got to book it. So I thought about it, and I called Irv Zuckerman and called him. And I said, Irv, you and I need to be partners on everything that's on arena level or bigger. And he said, why would you do that? I don't want you promoting to my market. And you're not even a promoter. We were managers at the time. I said, I know, but Hewlett and these guys bought this amphitheater, so I got to do this. And he said, well, why would I do that? And I said, well, because I'm going to call all the agents that manage all of our bands and tell them if they don't sell me the concerts in Kansas City, they're not going to be representing our bands anymore. And you can ask Mitch Rhodes. He hated this because he was the first one, and he was representing Warren at the time. That's why he always hated Hewlett. And I called him and said, and it wasn't even a band we managed. It was like Janet Jackson. And I said, I want Janet Jackson at Kemper. And he's like, what do you mean? And I said, well, if you don't give it to me, you're not representing Warrant anymore. I'm just was told to pass on the message. And I got Eric Clapton, I think, was the second one. My third phone call was Irv saying, uncle. And we were partners for the rest of the year. So, but the point is, if you're the manager, come on. You know, the manager tells the agent what to do, okay? And so, you know, I respect what they've set up. It's great. They got managers and promoters. Great. Go do your stuff. A lot of other guys out there, okay? We don't have a factory. And we got a bunch of individuals that do really cool stuff. So,
Look, I support agents. I really do. I think an artist should have a third, you know, they should have their own independent opinion and people like that. Not everybody is as versed in live. They may be more versed today in the internet and social media than they are in live. So they need people around them that understand the live business. And an agent is perfect for that.
We were talking earlier about, Paul and I were about longevity and about how a career, by some sense, the Rolling Stones shouldn't even be doing this anymore, but you're doing it with them pretty much right now or recently. And it's the bands that probably didn't think much past Thursday or Friday are 30, 40, almost 50 years into their careers and still doing really well. Whereas in the present day, people tend to come and go rather rapidly because of just the way things are consumed. Music is consumed almost virally now. A star becomes a star, and it tends to come and tends to go a lot faster. So can, you guys both can speak to that. I mean, and your role in that. How does, you know, the live touring and performing, how does that sustain a career, especially now when it's so tough to?
I don't know. How does an act attain sustainability?
Man, I don't know.
It's just a different era, different situation there. The music meant everything to so many people back then, and now it's just a commodity, you know, to some people, to a lot of people, and that's, you know, because your movies and sports and all these other things just split so many different directions, you know, the audience. That back then it wasn't like that, you know, when the Stones were coming up and just so many great hits and so many people just had to see them, and you still have to see them. They're just amazing. But I think that's kind of a, how do you do it now? I don't know.
Well, there's a lot more. You raised an interesting point, a good point, which is there's so much more competition for people's attention at this point. Excuse me. And they can get it. They can get what they want instantaneously. Everything is on demand now. And you can't really have U2 on demand. You can't have the Stones on demand in a live situation. It takes planning. It takes logistics and other things like that. John, what do you think?
You know, I still believe, listen, I know you got to have hits or people are going to come see, I guess, or whatever. But I've always believed in the live experience. And as long as, you know, again, this is something I think we talked about once before. I mean, we did years and years of Neil Diamond tours. And a lot of people here did. And you spent, you know, five nights in every city. And that went into the 80s, into the 90s. And the last time the guy really had a current piece of product was in the early 70s. So why does Neil continue to sell, okay? Why? Because we love him. Why did the Grateful Dead continue to sell? Why do, you know, so I think there's some truth in what Paul's saying in very much that, you know, music used to mean something, you know? Used to mean something to us and you know, it used to register with us and it was why we did things and that. And it's pretty commercial and pretty static in a lot of ways today. So maybe live is really our last bastion to go and really feel that experience. I don't know.
You said, talked to you earlier, you were saying that, you know, what you really are and why you do. So tell me, why
we're carnies.
We're
all just carnies. I mean, that's it. We're just like, I mean, maybe got nicer clothes today or something, but I've always thought we were carnies. And we like to go to town and set it up and do a great job at it and pack it up and move it to the next town. And I don't know. I probably, you know, I would have run away in the circus. I didn't know how to, you know. But it goes back. I want to go back to the what is it that drives us is kind of what you're saying. Okay, what drives us today? We love what we do. Okay, and I think a lot of the people in this room love what they do, okay? And it's, like I said, I didn't want to wear a suit, and I didn't want to go punch a clock, and I'm not the big, I don't want to be the big corporate guy. I want to do my stuff and do a great job at it, and as he, I think, has taught me more than anybody else, get it right. That's all we try to do is get it right.
It's a good life goal and philosophy.
It is. After you boil it all down, it's like, what the fuck are we doing? I'm trying to make it right. We're just trying to do it right. You know? You go to any of these guys, Springo or Charlie, any of these, Jake, anybody out there, you just say, what are they all trying to do? We're just trying to get it right.
That's it.
I think the excitement is when the house lights go out and you get that massive burst of energy from the crowd. You know, it's just when you think about all the people talking about, when are you going? What are you doing? How are you going to do your hair? What are you wearing? It's just this massive amount of energy all culminates when those house lights go out.
Yeah, Pete, that's exactly. It's good to hear that you'd think after all this time you guys would have been jaded by that. It's just another night, another gig, another this and that. But you still get that rush when you see them?
No. I think if you turn it into a bunch of widgets and all that kind of stuff, you get very jaded on it very quickly.
Yeah.
So I think you got to keep the passion, you know?
Mm. Oh, that's interesting. You know, they were going to roll some tape at you guys before we started, and some video behind us, and so if we could maybe get that up on the screen now, and then we could take some questions after that. I'm sure you got something to ask these guys, but if we roll that now, that'd be great.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
So the award goes to Prince.
Part of the reason why I'm here is because of John Meglin and Paul Gongelware and AG. They helped me to facilitate the vision that I was trying to get across.
But at the first meeting, really what we were doing was telling Michael Jackson about our company and all the different assets that AEG had. And Michael got very excited about that. He was saying, you know, I really want to work with these guys.
The Cubans were doing everything they promised. Opie, I know, has production covered, so I was starting to think, hey, maybe we got this. Maybe it's actually going to work. And then, out of the blue, the Pope decides to pick a fight with the Rolling Stones.
We done?
We done? Okay. How was that?
That's great. We didn't talk about I forgot to ask you two things. One of was getting back to Prince again, the Super Bowl halftime show, and that was apparently, you know, an experience from either heaven or hell or both. And so tell that.
No, I think the story everybody likes to hear is about, you know, when you do we've both done a number of Super Bowls, but when you do the Super Bowl, you know, your last dress rehearsal, they tape it, because in the event something happens and you can't, you know, you just can't do it or something, they roll the tape. So you're out there rehearsing in this tent, you know, that was Miami for Prince, and we're outside in this tent for like 10 days doing all of this crap, and he never once turns his guitar on. He never once turns his vocal on, you know. And the first time he decides to turn it on is during the dress rehearsal. So he does it, and it sounds like shit. I mean, it's as bad as you could get. And it all the way down to when he gets to his little toaster to take him back down under the stage, he steps on the mic stand, and the microphone hits him right in the forehead, you know. And he's like all pissed, and he gets in his golf cart, goes back to his trailer, and a few minutes later over the radio you hear the principal would like to see John Meglin and Don Mischer in his trailer, right? So Mischer and I got to go into the trailer, and he kind of waves me over, Prince waves me over to one side, and he says, "No, I want you to get that tape." You know, and Mischer can hear everything on the other side, and he's going, "I'm not giving up the tape." I'm not, and Prince is going, "You got to get that tape. You got to get that tape." Oh, man, but I got to tell you, he nailed it. He absolutely nailed it that night. I think, and other guys may attest to this, but when an artist is doing a Super Bowl, I think that's as nervous as I've ever seen any of them. And I think they realize the magnitude of how big and how global this whole thing is. And they get really, really nervous. He was amazing afterwards, but 10 days leading up to that, he was a nightmare.
you know.
It rained. Didn't it start raining in the middle of his performance as well, on top of everything else?
We got lucky. We had purple rain. Actually, Gongaware set that up. Who did that for you? Who did the effect on the rain? Who brought the rain on Super Bowl halftime?
We left that to God.
Take us to Cuba now and revisit that story that you were just, we got a little fragment of it when you took the Stones to Cuba. That itself is an accomplishment. And what about the logistics there? It sounded like it was pretty complicated.
You want to talk about Cuba and how we moved it?
Why don't you talk about Adam and how we did it?
Oh. It's really funny. Adam Wilkes, who I was talking about. By the way, we have amazing people in our organization, okay? We really do. People like Kelly DiStefano and Mark, you know, Mark Norman and Craig Schneiderman and Bobby Reynolds and Amy and all. I mean, I want to go back. The way this stuff works is by we have amazing people. So Gongaware called me and said one day, he said, look, I got to be at every Stone State. You're going to have to go do Cuba. And I'm like, I don't want to go do Cuba. And Adam calls me, and he's like, I want to do Cuba. And I'm like, you're in China. What do you know about it? He said, I did a semester at University of Havana. So that was the most qualifications we could find. So Adam ran point on Cuba. But what happened is it took us a while to figure out who to get to. We started working on this. I remember we were having meetings up in Montreal on 15 when we were doing that. And we first had to figure out how to do it, how would we pay for it, what does it cost to do. But we finally get and we dial in on a date, and we dial in on March 21st. And we're moving forward and all of that. We're in Buenos Aires, and we're actually at the ambassador's residence in Buenos Aires, Noam Ahmet's house, looks like. And he comes and says, look, you guys are screwed. POTUS is coming in on the 20th. And I'm like, who's POTUS? He's like, it's Obama, you know? And I'm like, well, we already got all our hotel rooms. How many does he need, you know? And by the way, do you know that he has 650 hotel rooms when he travels? We were at 350. I'm like, what does he need 650 for? Okay, that's where your tax money goes. Anyway, so we're pissed. And we're like, so they pull Adam in and they go, look, the same guys that are doing your concert have got to do the president thing, and we can't do both at the same time. Can you guys come a month later? Now we're like, what are you talking about? We're finishing on Mexico City, we have 3 days off, we're flying by. A month later doesn't work, okay? So we go back and forth, they come back and they say, okay, can you guys do March 25th? And we look at our calendars and we go, that's Good Friday. And they said, no, we don't have religion down here, don't worry about it. And we're like, okay. If it doesn't bother you guys, we're fine. So now we're in Mexico City. We're like days from going there, and they call us. This is what Paul was talking about. And they call us, and they go, okay, the Pope just called Raul and doesn't think that you should be playing on Good Friday. And we're like, what? And they come back to Adam, and they go, okay, we figured it out. 12:05. I go, what do you mean 12:05? They're like, 12:05 on Friday night. It'll be Saturday. We're like, you're going to hoodwink the Pope on a technicality? And we did, you know, and you got to give Joyce the credit, because Joyce was the one who said, look, Rolling Stones have never taken a position on politics or religion. They're not about to now, which is really the right answer. But we had, like, first we had Raul, then we had Obama, then we had the Pope. We were waiting for, what's his name, Kim Young to join in and do something.
So how was the show?
Show was fabulous, man.
We had to take everything. We took in 61 sea containers. We brought in about 300 crew and a 747 freighter.
Two freighters.
This is all on the surface of, well, how many shows is this? Was it just one night?
One show. Because a very expensive one show.
Yeah, I would say so. All right. We've got some time left here, and I'm sure if you have some questions, shout them up and put it to these guys. Anybody have anything they want to know?
No, we're done.
You're done?
We answered all the questions.
Okay, I guess, yes.
We answered all the questions.
Yeah, please.
Quick question. You were saying that you hate discounting tickets. How do you feel about services like
The question, for those you probably couldn't hear, was that how do you deal with Groupon and people, if you don't like the secondary market, how do you deal with these sort of spontaneous things that just kind of pop up? What do you do?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, me, I hate it. I just hate it. I mean, it just means that we're selling shit, okay? It means that rather, you know, let's put people in the right size venues, okay? You know? If you can't sell out a stadium, play an arena. If you can't sell out an arena, play a theater. You know, it's like play where you should. By the way, that will benefit you in the long run, but people don't want to believe that, see? It exists for weakness, is my feeling, okay? And I think it contributes to weakness. And the more it's done, you know, then I don't know what we become.
We don't do it.
I hate it. Did I tell you how I feel about it?
Yeah. Yeah. Did that answer your question? Okay, great. Anybody else? Yeah, they're back there, please.
So do you pay for then, or do you just let the show do what the show is
going to
do?
The question is, do you paper then, or do you let the show do what it's going to do?
We rescale. Listen, ticketing is a living organism. You're doing it from the get-go, okay? And you constantly move and move and move, and you have to, it's not like I put everything up at one price and see what happens, you know? I'm a big fan of wide distribution. I think if you increase your distribution, it's going to help out a lot. People don't realize when we did like the, what was the last Stone Stadium tour here in the States?
Here?
Yeah. 3 years ago? 2 years ago?
Yeah.
You know, I very much limited the number of tickets that we put out each day because I wanted to make sure that I didn't have any unsold seats. So control your inventory a little better.
The effect with the Stones is trying to maximize income. Is we've been pulling out of stadiums $9 and $10 million a show. We just did Vegas, one show in an arena, and grossed $7 million. And it's how you do your ticketing. It's how you price your ticketing, how you scale things, and then how you move those prices around as demand and supply and all that warrant.
And I maintain it was always there. That's the worst part. The worst part is that money was always there. We're just now starting to get it over on our side of the fence.
Anybody else? I guess not. Any parting? Wait. Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah, please.
You guys did say something earlier. If it gets too widgetized, you lose the passion for it. But in the kind of shows you're talking about, you know, an interesting tension is, you know, for the logistics to work, it has to be widgetized and repeatable and systematized, you know, show in, show out, to a level to make it work. And I'm just wondering how you kind of creatively ride that tension where it is, you know, a regular systematized thing every day, and yet it allows space for kind of the magic you were talking about, for lack of a better word, to happen, you know, per performance, every individual performance.
You know, part of that is style, okay? Part of that is if you look at each artist individually and you really believe that each artist is different, then by nature, what you actually create and design should be different, okay? You know, some people, it depends on what's more important. You know, many different things are important to different people, I guess is what I'm saying. And so you try to dial in on that. You try to make, you know, we try to make the road comfortable. We try to make the business comfortable. You know, we try to, it's not about us, okay? Nobody's ever, well, it's obvious. Nobody buys tickets to Paul and John. You know, nobody buys tickets to Concerts West or these type. People go to see their artists. So I want to keep the focus there. I want, you know, and through that process, that creativity will happen if you allow people to do what they do.
Question down here.
Has the Stone Show in the Battle of Free Will, who paid for it?
The one in Cuba?
The question.
There was a philanthropist who put up a large portion of the money. The rest of us contributed.
Well, we were okay until they moved it back 5 days, and that time period was going to cost us close to $2 million to extend our tour that far. So we had to dig deep and find different sources. Actually, John and I threw in a sizable chunk as well just to make it happen. But we did have that philanthropist who wanted to give this to the Cuban people, and that was a huge chunk of it.
It's very expensive if you're thinking of doing one down there. And there's nobody down there that can buy a ticket either.
Anyone else? Questions? I think we'll ring you no further, as they said okay. In the paper chat.
Well, I hope we didn't bore you all.
Let's thank our guys here for a great show. Thank you.